So thank you for the nice introduction. I'm Szilvia Béla, and I would like to present our joint work with Márta, Szilvási-Nagy. We are coming from the geometry department from the Mathematics Institute, so forgive me if I'm going into mathematical details too much in my presentation. I will talk about how to change the parametrization of B-spline curves and later surfaces to gain some end condition to change tangent and curvature data of our curves and surfaces. So first of all, I would like to give a short overview about our curves, what we use for changing the parametrization and gain these tangent and curvature conditions. These are the B-spline curves, already well known in CAGD, and these curves are defined with node vector and control polygon, and our curve is a linear combination using the control values of certain basis functions, B splines, B stand for basis, and these basis functions are special, given by a recurrence relation, what I have written here, but it's well known, and if you look at the picture down here, you can see how these basis functions are connected with our node values, who they are living here in the x-axis, and these node values are in the recurrence relation how we define our basis curves or B-spline basis set. So these basis functions are defining our curve, and a combination of these basis functions are able to build up two or three dimensional curves depending on the dimension of our control points. They form our control polygon. Here you can see an example curve, and of course these node values, what are given in order to define our basis functions, they play a role in the parametrization of our curve. So here you can see some points, some connecting points of our defined curve, and these points are related to certain control value, certain node values, and divide our curve into curve segments. These curve definitions are really practical. We have piecewise, smoothly connected polynomial functions, and we use the advantages of this definition in order to manipulate these curves with manipulating the parametrization of this curve. In order to show how a manipulation goes on the parameter domain, I have to summarize the techniques that are used for manipulating the parametrization of these B-spline curves. In the literature, you can find the technique of node insertion and node removal, which means that in the parametrization, we change the number of node values, we insert one or remove one, which means that we change the number of our basis functions. We get more basis functions or a sparse basis on this parameter domain. These two manipulation techniques are really important, and if we go further, we can easily build up a technique with repositioning a knot in this node vector. Obviously, we can gain a repositioning if we insert a knot and then we remove another one. So, with this technique, we can make a repositioning in the node vector. Of course, we could compute this repositioning in a reverse order. First we move a knot and then insert a new one. And there exist certain direct recursion formulas in order to compute a reposition of a node. So to compute the change of the basis functions and to compute the new curve, the changed curve. Why do I speak here or write here that we have different removal methods? The reason is simple. Node desertion causes more basis functions. It means that if we want to model the same curve with this larger basis, then we have no problem. We can carry out or compute the control points in order to have on the larger basis the same shape of the curve. But for removal, we don't have this luck. We have a sparser basis, so it happened that we cannot model the same curve on this sparser basis. It means that we only have certain approximation after the removal of the node of our curve. So the node removal technique is not exact, and we sometimes cannot model the complete shape of our input curve. That's why we have different removal techniques, and it implies that we have different repositioning techniques if we are using removal in the repositioning. So here is some mathematics. Here is the computational method, or the older computational methods to reposition a node with insertion and removal. It means that our nodes are changed such that the nth node moved into another position, denoted here by tau. We have the insertion and removal and the removal insertion technique. First, let's consider if we insert a knot and then remove it. In the first line, you can see that this computation can be done by some matrix product on the control values. We can get the new control values after two multiplication of matrices. The first multiplication is done as we would insert the tau knot value, and the second multiplication is done in order to remove the unneeded knot value TL from the knot vector. Here this removal is done as a reversal insertion method. In fact, we just would like to invert this matrix multiplication here. Since we don't have squared matrix here, we use a so-called pseudo-inverse of the matrix, and we can easily invert the insertion method and get a removal method. That's our first possibility to reposition a knot. A similar technique, if we insert a new knot value, but we remove the old one, such that we, using recursive computation, going backwards or forward in the control polygon. It's another technique. If we cannot remove the knot without changing the shape of the curve, these techniques are going to give us different results, different curves, but all curves are approximating the input curves, input curve, of course. And the other possibility, if we change the order of the insertion and the removal, and first we remove the knot and then we insert it, it also can be represented really easily by these matrix multiplications on the control values. So let's see some examples. What will happen with our curve with this insertion and removal methods? On the left, you can see the input curve with black and the output curve if we first insert the knot and then remove a knot. In the right, you can see first removal and then insertion. Obviously, these methods are generating first approximating curves, output curves to the input curve. Why? Because insertion always keeps the shape of the curve, but the removal modifies it. If we first remove a knot, then we get an approximating curve on the spousal basis defined, and then we insert a new knot, then we keep the shape of this modified curve, of this curve with spousal basis. So in this case, obviously, it's not a good technique. First apply the removal and then the insertion. So that's why we stay with the method, first inserting the new knot value and then removing the unnecessary one. This was our first observation, and then we tried to gain a direct formula in order to compute the knot repositioning with one recursive computation. We could gain this formula like in the removal methods, computed forward or backward on the control polygon. Both methods are giving the same exact result if we can do this modification without the change of the shape of the curve, but both are giving different results if the shape, the change of the shape is necessary after the repositioning of the knot. This computation can be also written in matrix multiplication form and can be computed easily. These are really sparse matrices, so with fast steps. What we observed here, that if we use this direct computation method and the knot is repositioned into the left from the old knot position, then the forward computed direct repositioning is the same as the forward computed removal after the insertion. So one output curve is common for this combined insertion removal and the direct computation, but the other one is different. Let's see an example. Here you see with the two output curve from the direct insertion and from the direct repositioning method, and you can see that one output curve is approximating the old input curve better in one side, one segment of our curve, and the other output curve is approximating very well in the other segment of our input curve. You can see it on the error measurement that it's right. It's a very nice approximation if you compute forward. Here we are we were moving our knot value into the left, so it's the same as the insertion and forward removal. And if you compute the backward insertion and removal and the backward direct method, then you gain a really nice approximation in the end of our input curve. So this direct method is really nice and giving us really nice possibilities to modify our curves. Here you can see an application of this knot repositioning in the end of the curve. If we reposition the second, the third, and the fourth knot of the curve, we see how it changes for the first, not so important, knot repositioning. The curve doesn't change, only the control polygon differs. But for the first important knot repositioning, we can extend our curve, or we can even gain a clamped, so-called clamped control polygon of the curve if we reposition all the knots into the first knots into the first important knot of the curve. With this technique, we can change
or vary the tangent direction in the endpoint of the curve. If we extend it, we vary, for example, here between this green and red position, our tangent curve arbitrary as we like in the endpoint of the curve. Therefore, we can generate, for example, surfaces with certain tangent bend in the edge of the surface, varies between two given vectors. That's one nice application of the technique. Or we can even extend this method in order to set not only the tangent condition, but also the endpoint of the curve and the curvature data in the endpoint of the curve. So getting a nice oscillating circle of the curve. Here in this example, you see a blue curve, which was the input curve, and with the modification of the control points and the node values, we could generate a curve with arbitrary endpoint, tangent direction, and curvature value. You can apply this method in order to get some surfaces with given some rotational surfaces with given edge condition in order to set the curvature in all edge points of the surface, or you can vary and compute different curvature conditions in the endpoint of our curve and generate different rotational surfaces using this varied end condition or curvature condition in the edge of the surface. And if you like, you can also merge surfaces together with this technique if you apply the above mentioned technique on a parameter curve of the surface. You can compute with different endpoints the same curvature condition and different tangent conditions in order to get smoothly in first and second derivative smoothly connected surface to sphere, for example. Here are some references, what we used in the work, and thank you for your attention.